Hi everybody, Scott Cart here, and welcome back to my lab. Today I have for you a remake of something that is widely used on the internet, which is one of my videos on how to measure inductance without an LCR meter. And just a warning up front, I had made a mistake on the original video. And so today I'm going to correct it. I'm going to show you where I went wrong. And the math is just as easy, but we're going to measure it slightly different. And I have a proof using Proteus. We're going to take a look at actual values compared to the nominal value and what it looks like when we simulate it. And that's what we'll use to judge the accuracy of this technique. All right. So without further ado, let's get into it. All right, welcome back everybody. So by the way, before we get started, if you like the t-shirt, I have a new design available down below in the link to my web store. Okay, so let's talk about the principles behind this. Okay, here I have an Excel spreadsheet. I'm showing you the values that I actually measured. Okay, so I measured this at 170 microhenry using this technique, and I used a good meter, a DMM, to measure my resistance. And so I have a resistor in series with the inductor, and we have a source for frequency. And the idea here is that we're creating a resistor network where we're taking advantage of the reactive inductance. Okay, and the formula for reactive inductance is XL is equal to 2 pi FL. So the reactive inductance is equal to 2 times pi times the frequency times the inductance. Where I made a mistake before wasn't necessarily super straightforward, but what I said was that the peak voltage that we'd be looking at on this node here would be half of the total voltage coming in, and that's accurate, but we need to measure it in phase. Okay, so we're not going to be looking at the peak voltage, we're going to be looking at the instantaneous voltage for 50%, or if we wanted to look at the peak, the formula is 1 over the square root of 2, which is 0.707. Okay, so let's take a look at what this looks like in Proteus. Okay. Okay, so here's our circuit, and I've gone ahead and entered a specific frequency. This is 30.77 kilohertz, and I'll show you how I came up with that here in a second. But when we run our simulation, okay, we can see that we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 divisions at 0.1. So we have a single volt coming in. And if we check at that point, at 1, 2, 3, 4, we have just over half a volt. Okay. And so that works out. Okay. So the blue at the peak here, when we measure it down, works out to half of A. But if we check over here, the peak here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, point a little bit. So we could call that 0.707. So again, the numbers check out using this technique. All right. So that's good. That's a good starting point. So what does this look like in real life when we hook it up to a function generator and an oscilloscope? And here we go. So you can see my oscilloscope's running, and we have a frequency of 30.67 right now. My peak voltage is 4 volts, And our peak on channel 2 is 2.8, which is pretty close to what we'd be looking at. So let's just do that real quick. So 4 volts divided by 1.414. Okay, 2.829 is what we would be ideally looking at. And that's with an experimental error. So I'm going to say that in this case, the simulation in Proteus matches with the physical measurements done on the lab bench. And so let's go back one more time. Let's take a look at how this is wired up together and talk a little bit more about the formula. Okay, so using our formula, I'm going to say that I want the reactive inductance to be exactly the same as my resistor. And so I've put in here that XL is equal to 32.6 ohms. The frequency we measured, okay, and we measured it at 30.58 kilohertz, okay. And we know that the inductance should be equal to cell C17, so C17, the resistance divided by 2 pi, the C18, right, which is the frequency that we measured. And then I simply converted it into microhenry by multiplying by 10 to the power of 6. Okay, so that gives us a nice unit to work with. So how I came about settling in on these values, I set my oscilloscope. Okay, I knew that I wanted to be about 4 volts, and I wanted to set my peak to 0.707, or the same trigger point here, down at 50%. And so I continuously adjusted the amplitude and the frequency until these points matched. And the reason I had to keep playing with the amplitude of my frequency generator is because there is a resistor in there. Okay, so I've got a resistor in the oscilloscope, and there's a resistor in my frequency generator, and so I'm actually losing voltage in other places, and that's why it's really important to measure the voltage at point A and at point B, and never rely on the frequency generator directly. Okay. So hopefully this video helps. It clears up some of the issues. And to answer one of the comments in the previous video, why would you want to do this? Because an LCR meter is much less expensive than a DMM, than an oscilloscope. And you're absolutely right. For example, I have a little guy here. So, for example, I have a small component tester, and I found that it's actually off quite a bit when I measure it using this technique. So this 180 microhenry inductor actually reads 120 on this. So my faith is not in this cheap guy. Now a good LCR meter, it does cost money. They are not cheap, and they're much more limited in what they can do. So if I had my druthers of something to purchase, I would be looking at buying an oscilloscope and a function generator and a good DMM far before I bought a LCR meter. Now, if you could get an LCR meter, if you could get a DMM that had a LCR built into it that was reasonably accurate, that's fantastic, and that would be a great option. All right. Other than that, Please keep the questions coming in. I'm sorry that I didn't get around to doing this video earlier. Somebody pointed out my mistake and it didn't quite click what the issue was. But sitting down and actually going through it one more time, yeah, you're absolutely right. I was incorrect in how I was measuring it, which was to measure the peak at 50%. And no, it should actually be 1/√2 at if we're looking for the peak. So thank you for your comments. Keep them coming. As always, thanks for watching, and I hope you have a great day. All right, bye now.